Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the TI5 qualifiers. We are live here from the hub since day number one.
Our second the hub,
the mega hub, the hub to end all hubs. We'll see. But we are into our second game now. The draft has begun, so we're going to go ahead and hop right into it. It's TongFu taking on HyperGloryTeam. In game one, Sin, we saw HGT not overwhelmingly dominant, but they look pretty good.
Yeah, they definitely look better than their opposition. I guess that's the best way of putting it. Like, neither team looked fantastic, but there's definitely a class difference, both in terms of drafting and execution. A big part for me about the concern for TongFu that I voiced in the previous game was that it just seemed like, as a team, they were not as coordinated as HGT. They had the draft, with how HGT played it, with the options they actually gave TongFu to take fights in that, a really tight squad would have maybe pulled that game back, actually. That's why I'm a little bit concerned for HGT going forward. It's one game. Like, we can't judge them based on that one game yet. So let's see what they show in this game. They're going to get their gyro again.
Yeah, I guess the big change here is this time around HGT have the first pick. So last game when TongFu had it, they went straight for Shadow Fiend. They banned out Rubick instead. I believe it was TongFu who banned him out, but he was banned anyway last game. So this is the changeup. HGT getting Gyro, like you said, again. Do you think Gyro should be given away in this patch? At least when 6.84, I think it was C, hit, he was like auto first pick. Did he get touched in D, or is he still...
Rocket Barrage got nerfed, right? It used to be 10 level 1, and now it's 8.
The damage got nerfed, yeah. But it's still the no cast point. So overall, it's still much better than like 6.83 and before.
I would agree. It's still better than the old Rocket Barrage.
Okay.
And if it wasn't, then the hero would start falling off, right? Then teams would lose interest if the new Rocket Barrage wasn't the case. So,
how do you think TongFu should be approaching this game? Like, the main thing for me last game was that HGT just wanted to lane dominate. They picked heroes that are really strong early, that can snowball and just break down any sort of pulling or stacking. They warded the Shadow Fiend's camp early. How do you react to that if you're in TongFu's shoes, do you think?
You probably get a lineup that can fight level 1, so you prevent the invasion if you want that to be a crucial part of your lineup. This time they don't have a Shadow Fiend, so it's possible they don't care something, and they're dire. Mm-hmm. So it changes things quite a bit. I would say, considering how poorly they dealt with Undying last game, I think they should pick it. Or they should have a very clear plan of how they want to deal with it, because I think HGT will just pick it again. Like, they have no reason not to.
Do you think he's still worth the pick against a gyro?
Well, it is a naturally pretty decent counter, but I would still say so. Okay. I think it's still worth it.
And it's also partially, like you're saying, a block pick, as much as it is, like, is it good for TongFu here? But they don't go that way. They go Rubick. It is an instant.
They can steal Tombstone.
They can steal the Tombstone. They can set up for the Lina now. Something they didn't. They had the Earthshaker, who's a decent setup stun. But there were times where that Fissure kind of worked against them, especially early on in the laning stage. It, you know, would block heroes away. Ultimately, ended up, I think, costing them a couple of early kills, and that's where the lane snowballed. So,
this is very LGD style.
LGD to some extent, Vici Gaming before them. Although they would normally do like the Rubick Lash, I would say, more often, or even Shadow Demon plus one.
It's just, I think at the Summit, LGD did this opening twice in a row.
And they won really both games, game. I believe.
Yeah. They looked pretty solid with those picks. Was that against IG?
Yes. Yeah, it was when they just destroyed IG.
Lower bracket IG.
Yeah. So that was a really one-sided match.
They're looking to take a page out of that book. I'm just worried if they have the execution for
the
it.
The polish,
this is,
basically.
This is not that easy to play. There's the Undying. So you're playing two fragile supports that want to roam into an Undying gyro who are awfully hard to roam on. So you got to bring your A game here, else like this Undying could ruin their ganks. And even if their ganks are successful, they still need a way to disengage and get out of the Tombstone if they don't have the power to actually take the fight after.
So you're HGT now. You already know what TongFu want to do. It's quite obvious from the first two picks. What's your reaction here? Do you pick a strong defensive support? Do you pick a great counter ganker? Do you just play your own game and not really worry about this strategy? What's the best way of countering this dual roam?
I think any sort of defensive support that, like, either something like the Treant that EG ran is actually really good against Rubick Lina kind of stuff, where they have They have a bit of burst, but not that much early on, and they don't have multiple instances of damage.
So would you prefer him over, like, you mentioned Abaddon last year?
Abaddon would be a great choice. That would be my secondary suggestion. The great thing about Treant is that he doesn't need to be there. So you get a little bit more flexibility with how you put your lanes, and he's really good together with Undying early on.
How about Dazzle? Do you like Dazzle in these types of games?
Dazzle could definitely work. I think Earthshaker, if they're scared of it too, is very easy to for breaking it up. They're actually going to ban Spirit Breaker that I was considering HDT might want to go for, but probably not because of Rubick, mm-hmm. but they still just play it safe here with the ban. I think either a defensive support or you just go in with confidence and you're like, we can easily fight them. We managed last game, why not do it again? But I think a hero like Witch Doctor this time is not the pick. He doesn't seem good here at all.
Let's see what. Oh, the air brew.
Here we go.
It's happening. Pretty good in the lane against Viper, who only has auto attacks last hit, so you can just get that 1 point in Drunken Haze. We've seen a lot of players like that. The evasion's obviously nice. So looking at like a brew mid, and then the big question is, do HGT want to do dual lanes like we saw last game? Do they want to go aggressive tri-lane? Do they throw just one here on the offlane? They've got a lot of options right now. But this is also a tough hero to gank. He's very tanky. And against a Rubick Lina, they have good damage here, but it's not like a guaranteed kill by any means on the brew.
Not if there's a defensive support that can TP in. If not, I still think they get the kill. But yeah, he's probably one of the best melee heroes at playing against Viper. Honestly, most melee heroes just get completely run over. But what? Like the player hero combination is great. The matchup is decent. Brew doesn't really, as long as Brew doesn't get run over in lane, if he trades farm, it's worth it for the Brew. Like almost every single time.
Because he's just going to have that impact
with Blink
in the team fights. Do you think TongFu want to change this up? Do we maybe see like the Timber goes mid versus the Brew, and then maybe the Viper goes to a side lane here? They also worth mentioning, they go for Timbersaw again.
Yeah.
Now, the last time when they did this, I believe one of these teams banned Disruptor in the last match. I forget who it was. But HGT go right for it, and one of the best ways to shut that Timber down is Disruptor.
Yeah, interesting. He's good against the other heroes, though. I feel like he doesn't care. Like, Gyro's good against him in lane, but if they safe lane it again, they don't care about that so much. I think he's decent against Undying. I think that's a big part of the reason they pick it, is against Undying. But, well, they ban Witch Doctor, so they're maybe considering this time around that it's a core Undying. I don't think it's a core Disruptor. There's absolutely no way they wouldn't run that in this game. So
I've actually
not sure why they're scared of that, to be honest.
The only believer in core Disruptor is I know Bulba was talking about it like a year ago. Mm-hmm. Never actually really saw it much. I think once or twice. Then there was the FY Midas Disruptor where he got refresher eggs. That was fun.
That's pretty sick.
But we just don't see games go that long usually nowadays.
Why? Okay, so does overwhelming odds count the zombies but not deal damage? Is my question. Because it seems like
it's twice now. They've gone for this Legion where it does give you really good lockdown against the Brew. I guess that's one thing it brings, which is more important this game than it was last game. They didn't have like that massive AoE teamfight ult that you want to counter, but still, it does feel a bit curious. There's got to be an idea behind this Legion, and I mean, maybe that's it.
I don't see what else it would be.
Even if it does count the zombies, is that good enough? I mean, is that a reason to pick the hero by itself? It doesn't kill them.
Yeah, I don't know. I feel like it's weird.
They clearly believe in these two heroes, though. Two games, they've gone Timbersaw and Legion Commander. Heroes that are not being picked by most teams, and I guess we're going to see if the idea works out.
It's possible the idea with the draft is that you can enable Timber. So when he goes in, generally the way teams counterplay is that you stun up the Timber and then you try to lock him down, but she can always give him that get-out-of-fight-free card, basically, with the press the attack, but that's not going to be the case this time. You can't press the attack Glimpse, and you can't press the attack Static Storm. So if he gets into a bad position, he's screwed. There's actually no safety net for the Timber in this game, more or less. They do last pick the Dazzle for HGT, so it is actually going to be a core Undying by the looks of it. So TongFu got that one right.
I love this Dazzle pick, though.
It's really good.
It's such a good hero. You're up against the duel, a lot of burst damage from Lina, the Timber, and this is an easy way to ensure you get off the brew split, that you get to drop the tombstone. And from there, TongFu, that's not really the kind of fight they want to be taking at that stage of the game. They want the quick pick and then just back off, find the duel, spread the map a little bit. They're not so much about these five-man engagements, at least not without a lot of farm. By the way, another mango.
Shout out to TI5 Mango.
Yeah, TI5 Mango is alive and kicking. James woke up. They've got people on the couch now, guys. So if you want some alternate commentary, some shots fired, that's your place to be.
So we're going to get a rune for Viper and a rune for Brew. So mid laner's trading here. It does look like it's just going to be the standard Viper mid. I think Air has played this matchup quite a few times in his Brew, so we'll know how to deal with it. It's one of those interesting matchups where if you don't get the idea of using the Haze early, you can actually get run over. This is how you have a chance in this lane. It's a very unique melee hero for mid matchups in the sense that matchups that most melee heroes lose, he can actually win. Same with TA. You actually have a decent shot who is just renowned for running over melee heroes, but Haze is just such an incredible value point.
It really is. And other matchups, it's totally useless as well, yeah. Like, say, versus a Shadow Fiend or something.
Yeah, you don't really care then.
All right, so we are going to end the NC HGT running the dual lane here, but off the bat, they're going for the lift. The combo wasn't right from TongFu, and while they may not get a kill just yet, they are going to start applying a lot of pressure. I mean, Sin, this is something you mentioned. Teams, this is not an easy combo to run. Sometimes the team wants to lift, pull them back, and then stun. Sometimes it's an up and down. You also have to be right in position with Alina as the lift happens. And not a big deal in this case, but don't seem to be quite in sync off the bat.
It's definitely easier to land than a Rubick Lesh. That's the really hard one. Rubick Alina is pretty easy in comparison, but it's still not, like, relative to a lot of other support duos, I feel like it's not that easy to play. So, like you said, not off to the greatest start here. Undying is getting CS in the lane. He's hard enough to kill as it is, and then you pair him up with a Dazzle, and I actually think this TongFu lane can kill him. Last game it was different because it was a Spirit Breaker, but now this extra heal from Dazzling, especially when he gets level 2, getting the Grave, is really, really good. If you can time it in a way so that you get off an extra decay as well, that could just mean 2 kills. And, well, speaking from experience,
they want that glimpse for Pretty Haw. They have another Thunderstrike. He's just out of range, though. Red should be able to skate away, and they will secure the 2-minute rune. So ZSMJ goes off the lane a bit, but with that, they'll get a haste rune. Would have been nice if it had been just a few seconds sooner. Viper, not the easiest kill for a Brew Gyro at this stage, but could apply some pressure, perhaps. So it is interesting. HGT, again, you mentioned maybe trying to deny them the Undying, but it seems like if they get Undying, they'd love their 2-1-2 setup. We're seeing it again here. And again, it seems to be working quite well. They're farming well on 3 heroes, Undying, as always, topping the CS charts. Not quite as one-sided.
As always.
I mean, this series, as always. Maybe not historically, but
known for being a great early game farmer.
Apparently, because he just wins the lane so hard, they don't want to go in. But yeah,
interesting
to
see mid.
This is a little more even than last time, though, it feels like.
Yeah, and I'm really curious to see how this mid matchup develops. I feel like on paper it's a 50-50. And so far, it is also what the farm is looking like. They were both 7-4. Viper got a little bit more of a grip, and he's playing back a bit here with the Brew because of the incoming rotation. I think they've completely figured out the smoke. It's fairly obvious from Timbersaw's position and the lack of supports up here. They still have the pole blocked. So when the pole is blocked, where could they possibly be, right? It's a very easy to call smoke.
It's blocked, and they have that ward as well. Yeah. Not only do they block the camp, but they see everything around that area. So yeah, it is super obvious, as you mentioned. And the one thing I noticed with LGD is they don't even wait like a couple minutes. They were going at like 30 seconds. Like even before the rune spawn, they'd be setting up for the smoke gank. It seemed like maybe that's what made it strong, is that it's like before you expect to see them in a lane, so you're not surprised when they're missing. I mean, sure, you're somewhere in the back of your head thinking about it, but it's different now when, like, you know the creep equilibrium, you kind of have a rhythm for the game, you're able to sit back and think about where they could be a little more.
Yeah.
Maybe more teams should be going for those just, like, 0-minute smoke ganks that we saw from LGD if they want to run this combo.
Disruptor's going to glimpse the LC trying to get the rune. I think he's still going to be slower. Oh, he's going to destroy it. Okay.
What a jerk. Pretty Haw's not a nice guy.
He's like, wow, that actually wasn't worth it because he was an Illu. Any other rune in the world.
Not even worth taking that creep damage.
No.
But overall, things are more even in terms of CS. We are seeing a bit of a lead develop here for HGT, but it's not quite as one-sided as it was last time around. And TongFu also not feeding kills. That seems to be the other big thing here. It seemed like they wanted to go on XTT, but they've been burnt by this hero before, and they're going to play it a little more cautiously, especially with Kaka backing him up. It's a level 2 tombstone. He's got the mango to ensure he can get off his full complement of spells. XTT wants them to go on him, and TongFu wisely not going to take that bait.
If this ward wasn't up there for the Radiant, I think this lane would go very, very differently. They get so much information out of this. If they couldn't see the rotations, like Kaka is actually only able to play like this because of the ward.
Did they completely whiff on both sentries? It looks like they did.
They used that sentry to counter ward another sentry.
Okay.
But they did it so late that the ward was actually gone, so they were trying to deward a ward that wasn't there anymore.
That's pretty costly.
That kind of sucks.
Well, so far, things are a little bit more calm and slow here. No kills early. I think at this point last game we had 6 kills bottom lane. So TongFu,
yeah,
have
true.
To be happy about that. When are things going to break down? Is it the Brew 6 for you? Is there a...
Like Brew Blink.
Brew Blink. And I guess Legion Blink, but Legion is not farming, so it's going to be a long time before he can pick one up.
And once again, this might not be the kind of game you want to get Blink on LC as the first item, depending on how it goes. Obviously, he's not dying this time around, so perhaps they will have a little bit more momentum in the game. It is a great setup for Timber. Duel is a very good way of getting them in position. If you duel someone next to trees, you can...
Oh, XTT, he wants to go in here. He was thinking about it. Not going to commit, but you can tell he's just running the numbers in his head. Like, can I get the tombstone out and quickly run a hero down, or will Timber have time to chain away? Wasn't quite below the threshold.
He's maxing Whirling Death again. I still feel like this is an unusual build on Timber. I get the idea, but if you look at the scaling of the ability, it's actually, I feel like it's not
the
that
chain,
good.
The chain seems like the best scaling
yeah,
ability.
You get another 50 damage per point. That's the only difference for 10 higher mana cost. The other one, you get another 40 damage per level. So a little bit less, but you get more
latch
speed.
Range.
You get latch radius. You get harder to gank. You have easier engages. Like that extra 10 damage, I don't feel like it's really the...
Or even getting like just an extra point of reactive armor is a possibility. You're up against the tombstone. We talked about that as maybe a reason for this Timber Saw pick.
I actually think a 1-2-2 build could be nice.
Yeah.
It's also great against Brewmaster.
I do get the idea of maxing out both nukes, though, because then you can burst someone very quickly. So that part does make sense. It's more the order in which he's maxing them that seems a little unusual. But Air is getting towards his Blink. And for those who were not around for the TI4 qualifiers, Air's Brewmaster almost single-handedly carried his old team, DT, to TI4. End up barely falling short in the end. They looked like they might even be favorites over LGD at one point there in the qualifiers.
Yeah, they...
But then the Air Brew got figured out. They were a little bit too reliant on it felt like.
And I think they tilted a little bit, too. They kind of ran out of steam. Oh, they're going to try this time.
This is going to be hard, though. That Grave comes out. They should be able to get off the Tombstone, but the Chakram going all the while. XTT, there's your Soul Rib. Doesn't even pop the Tombstone. He seemed like he'd just taken too much damage, but hey, I mean, they really haven't lost much off of that go. A lot of nukes from TongFu forces out a single salve and a Soul Rip. He's got Arcane Boots anyway, so he doesn't care about the mana usage. HGT are developing a nice lead here, and that Brew Blink is getting close. And with that, it really does feel like that's where they'll look to make a go and try and break these lanes down.
Brew and Undying together is just such an insanely strong duo at minute 10. I want to say it's nigh impossible to fight into with pretty much any sort of standard lineup. Brew split with Tombstone on top is just ridiculous, so... I think we're definitely going to see that. The question is if they can find a satisfactory opening. Like, if you get one or two kills with that, it's not the end of the world if you're TongFu, but if you get 3 kills in the tri lane and a tower or something like that, that's what really has a major impact on the game.
Oh. XTT, we've yet to see a highly leveled Tombstone get deployed this game. A couple of nukes coming out again. Just no real sense of urgency. They're content to slow roll this, just out farm, or at least keep up and farm in the offlane, which is very good for them. The nukes start to come out, though. Kambu trying to force that Tombstone, or at least the Grave out. Unsuccessful. Just waiting on the Blake, really. And I think he's just about got it at this point, Air. Yeah, 1,900 gold. Could he honestly even could go in on U9 potentially at that point if he's got a plus one here. As you mentioned, TongFu do not have great defensive supports. They don't have a Grave. They don't have an Abaddon or a Treant. No real way to easily disengage from that burst split. Meanwhile, point booster comes out for Kabu.
It's
going to be the Bloodstone build, it looks like.
Yeah, again, he has Arcane's point booster. Okay.
They do make a go again on XTT here. The Tombstone gets dropped. Grave coming out. The whole complement of nukes. He's very low already, but he turns and just does Undying things here. Gets nuked again. First blood goes to HGT once more. This time, however, it's a clean one for one, which honestly, I think TongFu pretty happy that's all it is, but now Air Watch is in. Oh, man. if they had just waited a second or two longer there, if they had a couple more moments, they would have had the blink on Aerosynd. Great time for TongFu to take a fight. U9's a jerk as well, apparently.
But once again, it's a 1-for-1 in a 2v3 lane, and they lose their first blood. Oh, wow. They actually just got someone.
Now looking for another hero. U9 gets pulled into a clap and a follow-up from Pretty Hall. There's the glimpse coming out. Call down deployed, but already the Bruce Blade gets used. They're just going to fight their way through this one with the Gyro arriving as well. They will bring down the Viper. But as you mentioned, the Dazzle did get picked off top, and they do force out the Bruce Blit. Doesn't look like HGT will be able to take a tower off of this, but they will pressure one at least. Support is likely to be inbound any moment.
I think this is good enough for HGT for now. Or sorry, for TongFu. Now the Brew Blink comes out, but they didn't get a big fight out of it. So now they need to wait for a good 2 minutes before they can try to make their first Blink Dagger play. So first of all, I think TongFu will see it. Unless if he's going to hide it for 2 minutes.
Here come the zombies. The chase goes out on Kabu. He's going to TP himself away. There's no stun to cancel that one. He'll make his way out. But yeah, like you said, Bruce Blake gets used. They get a Viper kill, which is certainly fine. But they're not snowballing. They haven't taken the tower. Score's only 2-2. They are, I believe, slightly out farming TongFu in general. Looking at the net worth, though, it's a very, very minimal lead. And that's with the first blood. Oh, mid lane, there's a blink in. They're looking to make the go here onto U9. He gets glimpsed back into a kinetic field. Static Storm was waiting for this as well, and he's got no way out. The cooldown's going to follow it up. They just keep on layering the AoE nukes out, and they will bring him down. No retreat possible.
And that's a bigger kill, in my opinion, than the previous one, because this time they didn't use Bruce Blit. So they're going to get the kill on the Viper. They will delay his mech, which is really key for their own lineup. Mech is the most important item for TongFu in this game, and if that gets delayed long enough, they might get one, if not two, brew team fights without the mech available, and that could probably secure them maybe two towers as well. And as far as, like, let's say the game is even, and the teams are just farming. On one side, you've got a support duo consisting of Rubick, Lina, where both of them aren't really getting that much. On the other one, you have a Disruptor who's already level 6, and you have a Dazzle who isn't as level dependent as the Rubick Lina are. So early game just favors HGT, I think.
They need Spell Steal this game. It feels like they have to grab Tombstone, Calldown, Bruce Blit, like one of those, ideally.
In one fight, all three.
Well, one. I think one will do. Maybe not all three.
Just get Ags. And
I mean, imagine if he does, though. Then things get really interesting.
Yeah. Then they better win that fight. Else he's gonna be.
I wish Gyrocopter Ags was more viable. That spell is just so much fun. But yeah, no,
I agree.
Not
I think
the go-to item.
I think it could definitely be buffed without breaking the ability. Like, keep the global part and do something extra about it.
You know, you brought up in the context of E-Home.
A third missile that stuns.
You're turning into Lumi here. Yeah, let's have a mini stunning culling blade that also, like, just deletes areas of the map, makes them impassable terrain. Random explosion send. Where are they? Yeah. Oh, I wanted to ask you. You mentioned Nature's Prophet. Have you gotten to play around with the new upgraded Ags for him? Is that remotely viable or useful?
I've seen it.
With, like, the Super Trance, I think it
twice,
is.
Twice, I think. I want to say it's very situational. I believe Vici Gaming actually used it in an official match. I think Bulldog has used it as well. At least he's used it in a couple of pubs just to try it out and see what it's like.
Satisfy his rat quotient.
I feel like it's good in push strats, where especially in the earlier portion of the game, you can rely on Wrath of Nature getting one or maybe two hero kills, and then those strong treants can really make a difference, as IPC will be picked off here by Smoke Gank.
It looks like TongFu is trying for a gank of their own, but the difference is this Disruptor is really far back, and they seem to notice. The Undying is starting to move towards bottom. Good defensive position here by HGT. They also, I believe, have their Glyph still available. Yeah, they do. They can hold this tower if they want to. Bruce Blit ready. They're going to TP in the reinforcements. And, well, Glimpse likely coming here momentarily. No, Pretty Hall. He gets blocked by the creep. So barely manages to find the Glimpse. But Red just walks out of it. Call down a complete airball. But that's okay. They've got more follow-up available. The Bruce Blit comes out. Going to focus down Kabu next. And the rest of TongFu probably need to be heading the other direction. There's your Cyclone from air. Setting up on the Viper now. Are they going to buy back? They have two available if they want to. Static Storm deployed as well. They race forward with XTT. They'll bring down a third here. There's the buyback. HGT just don't care. They keep on going in. That's going to be the fourth kill of the fight. And they're not done yet. They're going to find LPC as well. It's five heroes falling. A buyback for nothing. They glimpsed him back to the well. And HGT just doing work here. Brutal stuff.
And this time, TongFu won't have as good high ground and tower defense as they did in the last game. So if this early game is falling apart, this feels a lot more like a game that could... Like, they just... Okay, how much did they lose? They lost five heroes, two tower...
How much do they lose? Okay. Look at the graph, Sind. How much do you think they lost? They lost everything.
Oh, it wasn't updated.
Okay.
They lost more than that.
Just look at the it's not even the graph. It's like the little green pips at the bottom. There's like 20 of them. There's just nothing good here for TongFu.
I think Radiant won that fight.
Oh, you're a brilliant analyst.
Thank you very much.
You're so smart.
All right, here comes IPC.
I'm going to find LPC. Well, very quickly brought down. Now they blink Klep forward onto U9, and he's got no way out. The Dazzle gets used, and now they're going to glimpse him a little bit farther back into the Tombstone's protective arms. HGT will happily collect an additional kill. Now the call down. Kapu will find one, but they need a little bit more to pay for that buyback from earlier. They lose, in the end, three heroes. The Lina gets beaten down in the shadow of her own tier 3. They're not done yet with Kabu being pursued out. This game feels like it could be a lot quicker than the last one. And I got to say, the Undying has been a stable presence for them. But the Air Brew has just gotten a lot more done than I believe he was Viper last game. Feels like the Brew has just been on another level as far as overall impact.
I think it's his type of hero, too. I feel like he's a playmaking mid more than a farming mid player. Of course, if it's the best pick, it's the best pick, and you go for it. But he tends to shine on, I think, Brew as well as... I think he's played some really good Puck, too. I seem to remember that. And
I believe
there might be a third playmaker hero that I'm forgetting here. Hmm. But
I was thinking Boker, but I don't think so.
He had another
Dragon Knight he played a bit of, but that's not really a playmaking hero.
I'm thinking about the TI4 qualifiers, because they did have another hero up their sleeves when his Brew was banned.
What was it? Not Beastmaster. Not Tidehunter.
I can't remember. But definitely something like Brew or Puck, I would say, is really up his alley.
For now, the Brew appears to be the go-to hero.
Oh my god, he's got Atos.
If AUI is watching, he's happy.
It wasn't like, oh my god, he went Atos, that's garbage, but oh my god, he's farmed. But
that would be a really passive. That would be an extremely passive aggressive. Oh my god, he's going Atos. What an idiot.
I am not a fan of that item. That's no secret, but
I mean, I think Atos this early is pretty strong, though.
For sure. It's definitely going to work.
For now.
Now, with that said, he could have probably bought something else. That would also have been pretty strong.
You're worse than Merlini with the Vanguard hate, man.
Oh, he hates Vanguard?
Yes. He thinks it's the worst item in Dota.
He doesn't know what he's talking about.
Even with the buffs.
He probably loves Atos, too.
The thing is, it's been buffed so much, he can't really hate it anymore, but he still tries.
Oh.
A little more hesitant. They find red. Here's the smoke gank.
Dead.
You can glimpse him back in the kinetic field, and well-timed. He's going to try to heal himself up, but to little avail as he keeps on taking the claps, the smacks from air. They'll bring him down as well.
TongFu. Dead.
TongFu at this point.
TongFu dead.
Yeah. That's pretty much the summary of how this game is going right now.
He's had a hard game in the LC. I think, was that his fourth death? Or it feels like, yep, it was his second.
It really, like, even...
I like everything. You actually just saved me. You don't even... I was sure you were going to mock me for that. You just let me be. That's cool.
You're doing all the work for me here. I'm just trying to cast some Dota. You're busy making an ass of yourself all on your own. You're doing a good job, Sin.
All right, there we got it.
I mean, this Legion Commander Timbersaw duo, do you feel like it's paid off for them? Because they clearly think it's very strong, because they've gone for it twice in a row against somewhat similar drafts.
All right, so they lost last game pretty hard, and they're getting stomped.
Do you think that's the heroes, though, or is that just the execution?
I don't see the synergy, really. I think it's both. There doesn't seem to be the greatest synergy, and they're also just getting outplayed.
Those wards, I think they saw it.
They
may want to fight.
But I
they have Brew Split. I mean, they could just look to go in here, and they're going to play clap on multiple heroes. Can they focus air down? No chance. It looks like Static Storm coming out. Now the split. It's 1, 2, 3 down, and Timber likely to be next. Tries to chain away. Ain't going to happen. Mercy was given by the neutrals, but that was a much more convincing showing. As HGT seems they're warmed up now, Sind. They're going to take the set 2-0, showing why they are one of the favorites here in China.
Yeah, I love seeing these creative picks from TongFu, but I don't know. I still don't really... There's a couple of things I don't understand. Like, the Legion Commander, to me, doesn't fit into their lineup. They play a safe lane Timbersaw twice in a row who maxes Whirling Death. So his mobility in the early fights, like when you're level 7, I think there was a stat that apparently 7.3% of the time Timbersaw maxes Whirling Death by 7. So I think the remaining, like, out of the remaining 92.7, about 80, you
good,
max...
Good math, by the way.
Out of the remaining, you max... you max chain by 7, or you have 2 points in reactive armor. Like, every timber saw gets 1 point in whirling death. So I don't know. I feel like that was weird. The Legion commander didn't make too much sense. And in both games, their safe lane, tri lane, lost to a dual lane. Like, that can't happen. Then you don't win.
The other thing in this game was they went for that Rubick Lina, and they didn't go for a 0 minute gank. They didn't succeed when they went for ganks. Their pole camp got blocked, so it was obvious when they were. It does feel like there's an element of just outplay.
They got
HGT
outplayed really hard
in
this
anything.
Game.
And with that, we can bring back the rest of our panel here. We have Zayori, Toby standing by. Hey, guys, how you doing?
Hi. We're good.
We made it back just in time. That was a pretty quick game number two.
Yeah. Much more convincing, it felt like, than game one.
Yeah, absolutely. Undying Gyro seems to just be too strong. I'm surprised they banned the Shadow Fiend in the second game, them being TongFu. They just handed over the Gyro Undying again, and that combo is... It's just so this patch.
It almost looks like TongFu believes they can deal with the Undying by having the Timber Saw, because they mashed him up in the lanes both times. And in game one, we did see the kill potential. Like, that Undying dropped pretty quickly. I think it was about 10 minutes into game number one. And they're thinking, hey, we can actually kill this guy, the Whirling Death. That's the reason why we're doing this, because it gives us our burst damage and we can just take him out straight away. But they kind of got fooled in game number two. Like, I remember Sin saying in game number one, like, as long as this lane was just farming, and that was all, there was no killing, then it could actually be a quite decent lane for them. And then we turned into this farming kind of thing, but...
They still kind of lost that, anyway.
Yeah, well, they lost it because HGT knew what they were waiting for. They were waiting for their timing. They were running a dual lane safe lane, so Disruptor was finding levels. He knew once he had level 2, level 3 glimpse, they might find an opportunity on the Legion Commander, who can't do anything in that lane, really. And then you just wait for Brewmaster to get the Blink Dagger up, and then all hell breaks loose. And what are you going to do in the meantime? You had one smoke gank attempt on the mid brew, and they never even entered the lane. Like, they got to the ancient area, and they couldn't move back, because then you had Undying and Dazzle, and that's the reason why I think Undying was being so aggressive on the top. He was getting up in their faces and saying, keep your supports up here. You have a potential chance to kill me, so keep your supports up here. And it gave Air all the space in the world.
Well, and I mean, I think he is the clear MVP of this game. Air, yeah. To me... He's the reason why they win this game convincingly in 20 to 30 minutes instead of, you know, 45 plus minutes and having to really scrap and claw to take it home.
Yeah, I mean, Air is pretty much always their consistent playmaker. And if he doesn't have that good start and can't drive the tempo of the game, then that's where this team tends to struggle a little bit. So as Toby was pointing out, when you have all that space made for him, he's safe from gank rotations. I mean, you would expect him to take over like that.
I mean, the thing I liked better this game was they had the Dazzle for the dual lane. Like, there was some kill potential in game one. Honestly, I feel like there was very little kill potential, even in a 3-on-2 situation in that lane. There was multiple times where you could see these just baiting them in. Like, go on me as the Undying. I have a Grave, Heal from the Dazzle, Soul Rip as well, and a Mango, a Stick Charges. Like, they knew they couldn't go on him, so they just kind of sat there and passively lost the lane.
Yeah. And in addition to that 309 performance from Air, I think he was 15-1 in the Viper game. I think 15-1-11. And just
it wasn't
really tanky frontliner. Yeah.
It's just not a flashy hero, but he did his job.
He did his job, right. So I think it's fair to say he's the MVP of the series. MV hero of the series, probably Undying, I guess. It was played if that was played by Kaka again this game, he was probably my pick for MVP, because he kind of ruined both games for their safe lane, tri lane. But this time around it was played by XTT, I believe. So they swapped it around a little bit, but both of them played really solid.
So I want to ask you, Sindarin, very quickly, what don't you like about Atos? Why are you an Atos hater? I want some deeper thoughts here.
I don't know.
I'm personally a fan.
It's very, in my opinion, it fits on very few heroes, which is fine. Like, items don't have to fit on a lot of heroes, but it's just the cripple seems kind of underwhelming in a lot of scenarios. Generally, when supports tend to get Atos, a lot of the cores will start getting their BKBs, and then it's kind of useless. So then you're looking at the payoff, like what you get. You're getting an Atos, say, over a four staff or over a mech.
At this point, a Glimmer Cape or Solar Crest, potentially.
Those items have major impacts in every single fight. Like, they're situational in a different sense. Like, the thing about a four staff is you can't have a fight where four staff will not have a use, right? It's always going to be good. Mm-hmm. And then you're looking at something like an Atos, where if you have the right hero item combination and the game is going in a specific way, it can be great. You can, like, chase down heroes. I think in this game, for example, it works because they're far ahead. They just want to go into fights, find a target, slow them down, just kill them because they're far ahead. But in that sense, they could have got any other item and they still would have won, right? So it's also just like the value you get. The components, the really good thing about Atos was that it was buffed to give more health now. So I think it's 300 health for the Vitality Booster, and you get 25 end, I believe, from the two Wizardry staff. So it's
correct.
It's okay, but it's just like the application of the active, it's just not really... I feel like it's not good enough.
Well, you didn't say the real reason why you don't like it. because he likes it so
much. Yeah, he likes it. And Ben.
It must
does
be Ben
like it?
Does Ben actually
Vanguard
like it?
Vanguard is like
I'm
the best
sure.
item in the game.
I know he hates Vanguard with a driving passion. I bought a shirt with a Vanguard on
he
it
a
just
voodoo,
to rub it
he
in.
He has a Vanguard voodoo doll, a plushie in his room that he just stabs every night.
Oh, boy. All right, so coming up next, we've got Ehome versus TongFu Wang Zhou. And this is another one where I think Ehome pretty hefty favorites coming in, but should be a good matchup.
I would say so. At the same time, I haven't seen Ehome in this patch, so I'm going to reserve judgment.
That's true. Very good. So with that, we're going to have a break, folks, and then come on back because we've got a lot more Dota 2 coming your way here on the Sun Stream for the TI5 qualifiers.